Hi, I'm Melissa Cobb, come fly with AOPA. This week, AOPA files a friend of the court brief supporting Trent Palmer, an up-close look at an L-19 bird dog, and tracking Santa's around-the-world journey.
AOPA keeps flying safe, accessible, and fun by protecting your freedom to fly. We are the most trusted one-stop resource for all things related to general aviation. Become an AOPA pilot today.
AOPA has filed an amicus brief, or a friend of the court brief, in the Trent Palmer case. Now, we're arguing that the NTSB has consistently ignored key provisions in the Pilot's Bill of Rights when it comes to imposing sanctions on pilots. Now, we are receiving support from other associations in this as well. The Experimental Aircraft Association and Alaska Airmen's Association have joined us in filing this brief. Now, to refresh your memory, Trent is a pilot and YouTube content creator. He's been in a 3-year battle with the FAA over the regulation regarding minimum safe altitudes and a low-level inspection pass that he made of a friend's backyard when he was trying to determine whether or not he could land there. Now, the FAA had suspended his pilot certificate for 120 days, and the NTSB upheld that decision. Now, Trent has appealed that decision, and the case will be heard by the U.S. Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia Circuit. AOPA Legal Services attorney Daniel Hassing helped write the brief, and he said that the importance to the general aviation community goes way beyond the particulars in Trent's case, but goes straight to the heart of provisions that Congress had enacted for pilots. Hi, Daniel. Thanks for joining us today.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Now, what does this filing mean, and what is the importance to our members and the larger general aviation community?
Sure. So when the FAA wants to take action to suspend or revoke a pilot certificate, that proceeding is done in the NTSB. Congress has said certain things about how the NTSB has to do its job. For one, it's supposed to apply the federal rules of civil procedure and the federal rules of evidence to the extent practicable. Furthermore, the way it's set up is the NTSB is supposed to make its own determination about the facts and about how the airman is to be sanctioned, whether it's a suspension or a revocation. We are aiming in our brief to make sure that courts tell the NTSB that it has to apply those rules and that it has to maintain that independent fact finder and adjudicatory body. They have to basically do what Congress said that they have to do. And so this goes way beyond the specifics of any case, and it could potentially affect any airman who has a FAA certificate.
Okay. And why is it important to continue this legal challenge? What are the longer term implications of this case?
Sure. So the long term or big picture implications of this is that every person who has an FAA certificate, if we were to find ourselves in the hot seat where we were accused of doing something wrong and the FAA wants to take action against our certificates, there are certain rules that are put in place to make sure that the proceeding is fair, that we have an opportunity to present our case. And so that is the aim of our brief, is to make sure that those rules are followed and that those proceedings are fair for anyone who finds themselves in that unfortunate circumstance.
Okay. Well, thank you, Daniel. We certainly appreciate all that you and our entire legal services plan attorneys are doing on behalf of our members.
Well, thank you, and you're very welcome, and it's our honor and privilege to do it.
The L-19 Bird Dog was an observation aircraft and a front patroller in the Korean and Vietnam Wars. Cooper Perkins gives us an up-close walk around and talks about the features of this aircraft.
This is a L-19 Bird Dog, or a O-1 as in military terms. So this airplane was used in the Korean and Vietnam War as an observation airplane and a front controller airplane. So what they would do is they'd fly over the jungle, see the enemy in the trees, they'd flip around and shoot these white phosphorus rockets, and it marked the targets, and then the jets or the artillery would come in behind them and drop the bombs. Basically what they did is they took a 170, slapped rockets on it, put a bigger motor in it, cut the seats in half, and then they're like, oh, here you go. Go use it in the jungle, see what happens, and then here we are. So it climbs about 1,200 feet a minute at 60 miles an hour, and it has 65 degrees of flaps. So I can come down at 2,000 feet a minute at 60 miles an hour and get it stopped at about 300 feet, 400 feet. And I can carry anything I want legally, and it goes where I want it to go. So this airplane has crosswind gear on it. So what the gear does, if you land crooked in a crosswind, the gear kick out. So you'll be facing this way, but tracking that way. And the tail will tendency, you know, it's always trying to get squirrely on you. So when you're trying to calculate keeping it straight, but you're facing the wrong direction and facing this direction, it gets kind of confusing sometimes and it'll bite you. But work those feet and you'll be all right. It's a very, very forgiving airplane. Like I said, like any other tail, keep it straight on the runway and it's not going to bite you. It's pretty humbling, and it's a blessing because I take it to a lot of fly-ins and events and stuff, and I can't tell you how many times I've landed and I've had a Vietnam vet come up and go, that airplane saved my life, or I've had a couple people come up and start crying and they wouldn't even speak to me, and I finally got the story out of them and it's like, oh, that's heartwarming. So it's a big honor and opportunity to get to putt around in this.
Well, Cooper, I'm glad you're able to take the L-19 to different aviation events to share this piece of history and help support veterans. We have several updates for you this week on the advocacy front. First, Congress has passed a second short-term FAA reauthorization bill that extends the FAA's funding authority until March 8th. Now, the reauthorization bill has been hung up in the Senate since this summer regarding pilot training and retirement age provisions. Now, this bill is the most forward GA bill in history. It includes things like airport funding, workforce development, promises, and regulatory improvement. Now, AOPA is urging officials in Aspen, Colorado to reject a 2024 proposal, an airport fee proposal that would raise parking and landing fees for general aviation operators while lowering costs for the airlines. Now, the proposal would increase landing fees for GA pilots by 10%, and for aircraft owners who have rented parking spaces outside, they would be hit with 20% increases in fees. Now, this comes at a time when the airport has reported multi-million-dollar surpluses in 2022 and 2023, and the county stands to gain $500 million from Atlantic Aviation after a 2023 lease agreement that included egregious increases in rent fees and also a 100-fold increase in fuel flowage fees. On top of that, the airport has received $77 million in airport improvement program funding from the FAA since 2005. But AOPA has lost two dear aviation advocates this month. Former AOPA Vice President of Airport Advocacy Bill Dunn and AOPA Aviation Finance Company President Adam Meredith both died after battles with cancer. Bill vigorously and tirelessly advocated on behalf of general aviation pilots to protect our nation's airports for more than 25 years. He even continued helping us advocate for airports after he retired in 2014. In addition to helping save airports across the country, including Albert Whitted Airport in Florida, Bill helped launch the AOPA Airport Support Network Program and AOPA's Airport Watch Program. Adam was known for his aviation financial advice in Adam Answers in AOPA Pilot Magazine and Coffee with Adam on our social media channels. Adam came to AOPA in 2013, and he led his team to help hundreds of members pay for flight training or buy the aircraft of their dreams. AOPA President Mark Baker said Adam had a deep understanding of the aviation business, and he had a real passion for negotiating the best deals for our members. Well, chances are you have either trained in an aircraft with a Garmin GNS 430, 530, or maybe you have one installed in your aircraft right now. So the popular Navigators were introduced in 1998, and more than 120,000 units have been installed in general aviation aircraft. But soon, it's going to be more difficult to find and get certain repairs for those units. So starting in 2024, Garmin said it will begin scaling back certain repairs of those units. And that's because it's getting more and more difficult to find the parts to replace them. So for an example, because of advances in technology, it's harder to find replacement displays for the units. And so that is a limiting factor for Garmin.
So what we're really focused on now is we're offering programs. We want buyback programs that could be a trade-in. For example, bring the 430 to us in exchange for a GTN, and we'll give you a promotional credit for that. But we want the old product, because what we will do is we'll take usable components like that display off the 430, validate that they're still good, and then it'll allow us to keep support and repair going on the legacy product that way. Because our goal is to keep that going as long as we can possibly do. We don't want people to feel like they have to go to a new product, but we're trying to give it, make it options, win-win, so that you can get there if you want to, and that by us getting those parts back, we can keep the existing fleet of GNSs going longer. So I hope that's win-win.
They also said that you can still send in your 430 or 530 and they'll see if they have the parts available to repair it. We'll drop a link to that buyback program down in the description below. Well, while many of us pilots think more about parts availability, this time of year children are thinking about toy availability and Santa's whereabouts. Well, the North American Aerospace Defense Commander, NORAD, can help with that. Every year they set up the Santa tracker to track him going around the world on Christmas Eve. So about 70 people at NORAD actually help set this up, and they really go all out. They have a tracking website, noradsanta.org, phone lines, an app, and more. Now 500 volunteers all come together on Christmas Eve to answer the many phone calls that come in.
By far and away, the most common question we get is, when is Santa coming to my house? And it's usually from a child. And the answer we always give is, based on our tracking, we can give you a rough idea, but the main message we put across is that, hey, you know, you got to be in bed and you got to be asleep for Santa to come. I mean, he's not going to come if you're not in bed and asleep. He might come back if you go to bed, but you should go to bed now so Santa can come and deliver gifts for you and your family.
I hope you have some fun with that this year, and I hope you enjoyed this week's episode of Fly with AOPA, and I wish you all a wonderful holiday season. Be sure to like and subscribe to stay up to date on all our latest videos. And this week, we leave you with some footage from Operation Good Cheer. So we got to tag along with pilots in Michigan a few years ago as they helped deliver presents for children in the foster care system. This year, icing limited the number of GA aircraft involved, but those equipped for flight into known icing were able to carry on, and lots of people helped drive the packages as well. Be sure to send in your favorite flying videos. You just might see them on an upcoming show. If you're not already an AOPA pilot, we'd love for you to join us. Just click on the link at the end of this video to learn more about our trial membership. We'll see you next week.